on today's announcement and why the government feels that these new boundaries are so important.
Well, you know, we've announced the new boundaries of the Castle Parks. We announced our intention to protect the Castle Parks 16 months ago in Blairmore, and this is the finalization of the boundaries today. After a 16-month-long consultation with community groups, with municipalities, with users of many kinds, and environmental groups, scientists, and First Nations.
This was not met with all applause. There was some unhappy people in the crowd. What's your reaction to their concerns?
Well, you know, this is why we are continuing the conversation with everyone who is affected by the establishment of these parks. We have already had very good conversations with, for example, the Alberta Off-Highway Vehicles Association. They've worked collaboratively with our government on a number of different files, including this one, the Crow's Nest Passport Squad as well. You know, those organizations represent users that are responsible, that have a long history in this area. And we're going to make sure they've got the right kinds of supports to undertake their activities in places where the science supports that it's the best decision for the environment.
You also mentioned 44 jobs will be created. How will they be created and in what areas?
There will be some parks employment created by this decision. We've already hired new conservation officers and other types of jobs to manage our public land and our parks down here in Southwest Alberta. Because we did have so much conflicting use and quite frankly irresponsible use that has been allowed to fester over the decades of the previous government's mismanagement of the area. And so we have already invested in a number of new jobs and new positions on the enforcement side. We're going to continue to do that. But, you know, with new parks come new tourism opportunities, new interpretive centres, new hospitality and other jobs. You know, we're also looking at ways that we can properly support the Castle Mountain Resort to make sure that they are meeting the needs and of the region as well. So there are a number of other employment opportunities that come over and above the park's employment.
And this is another important way to maintain relationships with First Nations in the area as well.
Well, this will be the first time in Alberta history that we move forward with conversations around cooperative management for provincial and wildland parks. We're also at the beginning stages of those conversations up north, but it has progressed further with respect to the parks down here in the Piikani First Nation. This is a good way to ensure that we are properly sharing the economic benefits of parks, that we have the right kinds of interpretive facilities and so on in place, and that we've got the right kind of tourism opportunities, because when people visit Canada and Alberta from elsewhere, they want to learn about that history. They also want to learn about the history that we see in this museum here at the Kootenai Brown Museum. They want to see the full picture of Canada, and certainly the Piikani's involvement in that park will assist in that.
And this is your backyard.
Well, you know, for a number of my constituents in Lethbridge West, this is has been something that they have worked on for many, many years. This has been 40 years of scientists and environmentalists and others asking for protection of these parks, given their tremendous ecological significance. The Castle area is called the Costa Rica of Canada, given its biodiversity. And so, you know, what we have been able to do here is fill in a piece of the puzzle in terms of the Yellowstone to Yukon Wildlife Corridors to make sure that we've got headwaters protection for the drinking water that supplies the city that I represent and, you know, many, many people and agricultural activities throughout Southwest Alberta. So there are very good scientific reasons for doing this. Not the least of which is making sure that we've got the right habitat in place for our fisheries, for our hunters. You know, there are many, many, many different folks who take great pride and joy in this area. Hear from people about is a staged over time 5-year approach to these particular areas as we build up infrastructure in other areas. What happened over the last couple of decades with the previous governments essentially ignoring this problem is that off-highway vehicle users have not had the infrastructure that they need in order to appropriately enjoy that activity. We think that activity is appropriate, and we think it's a good activity for people to engage in the right places. So what we're going to do is make sure that they've got that infrastructure in place. Alberta Off-Highway Vehicle Association has engaged with me personally several times on how we can work together collaboratively to make that happen. They've got some really good ideas, so does the Crow's Nest Passport Squad. It may be that we are closing some trails over time thoughtfully and carefully within the two council areas, but that does not mean to say that there are not places to enjoy this activity elsewhere, and that's what the Premier talked about with respect to building up the infrastructure elsewhere where it is appropriate to do so.
Does that mean some trails will remain open?
It means that within the castle area, what is in the draft plan right now is a phase-out over 5 years. However, a draft is just that. It is a draft, so we can talk to the public about what that means and what it means in terms of citing some of these activities in other places. What we see in other places with large amounts of off-highway vehicles is that the province or the jurisdiction in question, whether it oftentimes it's in the states, they actually invest in the infrastructure, the bridges, the side roads, the paths, all of those things, to make sure that it's compatible with the environment around it. The previous government didn't do that, and so that's why we've taken this staged approach to Castle, so that we can look at other places that these activities can take place, that they're better supported over the long term.
How will the consultation process work? I know you said this is a draft and there will be consultation, so how does that look moving forward?
Sure, well, just to back up on what has happened already, in the last 16 months we have gone through one-on-one meetings with me, I just want to back up and talk about what the consultation process has meant so far over the last 16 months. It has meant one-on-one meetings with me, with officials, certainly also culture and tourism and others. Then we went into technical working groups last summer and last fall and heard from many of these organizations, including Crow's Nest Pass Quad Squad, off-highway vehicles, environmental advocates, grazing leaseholders, hunting and fishing advocates, and other enthusiasts. Those working groups then reported to us, and their input went into the draft management plan that we have now put out for the 60-day consultation. So 60-day consultation period means that the general public can engage with us online, absolutely. You may write us a letter. Organizations may also file their feedback in a more formal fashion. Any municipalities or others who would like to have specific meetings with officials are invited to do so. We will hear their concerns, and then there will be a process of a final management plan after that.
Proposing to mitigate the financial loss from logging in on trees in a community like Crow's Nest Pass.
Well, of course, it was the announcement 17 months ago around the termination of the C5 logging permit for Spray Lakes, and the conversations with Spray Lakes are ongoing and have been very productive in terms of finding an alternative. Cut volumes and alternatives, and so far we have had no job losses in Cochrane or elsewhere as a result of that decision, and we continue to talk to the company involved in finding a solution that works for everyone. As concerns the off-highway vehicles, we have had many conversations with Crow's Nest Pass Quad Squad, with the Off-Highway Vehicle Association of Alberta. We will continue to have those conversations. What we have found is that what they're asking for is appropriate infrastructure to support that activity in places where it is, environmentally responsible to have that activity. And so that's what we're looking at moving forward with them, in partnership with them, on how we best do that. That's why this is a 2 to 5 year window, the proposal is. To move some of the off-highway vehicle use where it is the most problematic from a scientific and an environmental point of view, headwaters protection, drinking water and other water supplies for all of southern Alberta. There are very serious concerns there. So staging it out over a period of 5 years from one place and where to. And those are the questions that are live. We've given ourselves some time to answer them. And we have engaged with this community of off-highway vehicle users, their associations, respectfectly, thoughtfully from the very beginning, and we will continue to do so.
So you're not saying zero tolerance?
Sorry?
You're not saying ultimately zero tolerance?
Well, the plan all along, and that off-highway vehicle associations and others with whom we have spoken, is that we will take a staged approach. And that's what's contained within the draft management plan. I don't know what rumors are out there, and I can't be responsible for that. All I can really be responsible for is what is actually the facts that were shared last night with the off-highway vehicle users groups via conference call, all of them, and with the municipalities that were all that are all involved in these conversations. But in many ways, they were part of the coming up with this plan from the very beginning. None of this is terrifically surprising to them, because we have had these conversations in order to inform the draft plan for the last several months. We had technical working groups working on these matters all last summer and fall. And so for the user groups that want to see responsible use in the backcountry, they want to see it appropriately supported and in the places where it makes the most sense to have it, we continue those conversations, and I really look forward to hearing their ideas. They've already been really, really helpful. For example, the Off-Highway Vehicle Association of Alberta has been helpful, not just in the council, but during the Fort McMurray wildfire. They were instrumental in talking to their members when we closed down the backcountry to OHV use. They were really, really helpful in that. And that shows their collaborative nature, I think, and we want to continue that relationship.
Okay, thank you very much, everyone. Thank you.